In April 2011, there was a burglary, which I found most peculiar. Two thieves broke into the Museum of Science of Coimbra in Portugal. They didn't take the cash, they didn't touch the computers, but they ran away with two 18th century rhino horns. So what were they doing? Who was behind this theft? And where was this rhino horn going to go? Let's park this mystery for a moment and the beast behind it. As a biologist, for the last 30 years or so, I've had the privilege of studying the lives of animals and working on species conservation. And I soon came to the conclusion that species conservation starts at home. And that is so because the way we run our businesses, the way we make our consumer choices, the way we purchase articles can have profound collective implications on oceans, on forests, on savannas, the homes of thousands of species worldwide. And yet, I need to illustrate it so that you get the point. So how is, for example, an opera outing in Europe related to orangutan conservation in Sumatra? The moment you pull out your lipstick, you have a product here which contains palm oil. Palm oil, you will find in about 50% of the packaged products of your average supermarket. And oil palm plantations have been expanding voraciously in Southeast Asia over the last three decades, sometimes encroaching on natural forests and on national parks, the homes of orangutan, of tiger, of the Asian elephant, and many other unique species from Southeast Asia. The good news is some industry leaders are really making a statement now that their plantations have not encroached on natural forests and that they are sustainably managed in order not to compromise the life of so much wildlife and biodiversity. And you can find a little label, hopefully, in many of those products in the supermarket that will help you guide your purchasing decisions. Now, let's face it. We are in a species extinction crisis driven by human activities. And I must tell you, I was very saddened and frustrated when I arrived in Costa Rica in 1995 and was no longer able to see the golden toad, this remarkable jewel, unique to the cloud forest of Costa Rica, had gone extinct in 1989. And the only thing left of the Costa Rican golden toad are these postcards, which you can buy in the souvenir shops. Extinction is irreversible. And yet you may wonder, well, why should I care about species? Let me tell you first why I care. 24 years ago, I underwent a watershed moment in my life when I survived the attack by a wild male chimpanzee. I was walking in the forest of Lake Tanganyika, and all of a sudden, this male chimpanzee called Frodo, by the local researchers, turned towards me and started charging at full speed, then jumped into the air and with his legs on my chest, kicked me down on the floor. He started jumping on my ribs. I feared that they would crack, so I started rolling to one side, and then I lied there, motionless, thinking of those images from textbooks that I had read about chimps fighting each other and sometimes killing the opponent with a single bite into the skull. So I thought, my life is really at the mercy of Frodo. And I saw him coming again. And he took his knuckles and started hitting me. One, two, three, 14 times. I was counting. And then something remarkable happened. Frodo stopped. And Frodo started grooming my hair in a gesture of apology, perhaps of remorse, and certainly of compassion with this poor guy that lied terrified on the forest floor. And then Frodo walked away. It took me a while to catch my breath and finally to pose the question, well, there was Frodo's compassion towards me. Where is my compassion towards all those creatures that I so much admire? What is my role? What is my duty here? And I decided to become one of the voices that protects them from human activities that compromise their survival. And when I look at these creatures, many, many species I consider intelligent, with emotions, many of them with a high level of awareness. I once saw a female baboon tell a lie. I was following this group of baboons in Tanzania, and the female saw a nice juicy beetle up on a shrub. But then she saw a male baboon that was coming from behind, much closer to the shrub, was going to get the beetle. And the female immediately uttered this cry, "Woohoo!" which in baboon language means, "Help! This male is attacking me! Help!" I know he wasn't. But everybody else in the troop particularly relatives of that female, came down from the trees and charged at the male, who looked up, confused, not understanding why, and then had to run for his life. And all of them chased him into the distance, except for one, the female baboon. She stayed behind, snatched the beetle, and started munching on it as she watched what the others disappeared in a cloud of dust. Now, yes, I know. Many of you, or many of us, will not have often a close encounter of this kind to motivate our conservation action. But for many people, species conservation and caring about it is as simple as species is food. Think of all those marine fish feeding about 1 billion people in developing countries and sustaining 600 million jobs associated to fisheries and seafood processing. But then there is timber as well, a commodity in very high demand around the world. Well, timber comes from trees, and trees grow somewhere. And that's definitely not in the stores where we buy our furniture. And then medicine. Thousands of drugs come originally from wild species of plants and insects, are then synthesized in the laboratories and packaged nicely in cardboard boxes so that we can very comfortably enjoy them directly from the pharmacy without having to embark in a rainforest expedition every time we fall sick. So people care about species because they care about food security, about health, and about jobs. But there is another lot of people. They care about species because they like to go to the wild. In the wilderness, they experience mental relaxation, some spiritual replenishment, sometimes artistic inspiration. And it all starts with your Sunday walk to your nearby forest. But sometimes it can take you to remote places to watch extraordinary animals like gorillas. In Rwanda, gorilla tourism is a $300 million industry every year, benefiting villagers around gorilla habitats, but also the main source of foreign income for Rwanda. In Costa Rica, it's nature, it's its primary asset for an economy based primarily on tourism. And then there is whale watching. Okay, whale watching is mostly done from boats. On the surface, underwater is an unusual way of watching whales. And whale watching industry in 2012 had a turnover of $2 billion. And it's an industry growing at about 10% a year. Recreational divers already 20 years ago were spending $4.1 billion to go into the water, underwater, and then watch the little animals in there, little species, and the big ones as well. So people then care about species because their jobs depend on species. And others care about species because they derive non-tangible benefits by being close to nature. Now, there is much more to species conservation than food, health, raw materials, spiritual replenishment. I'm thinking now of the perspective of a head of state in Africa. Now, more than 20,000 elephants are being shot every year. And two elephants will probably have died in the hands of poachers by the end of this presentation to satisfy a market for ivory over in Asia, particularly in China and in Thailand. Organized criminal gangs are bribing their way through the judiciary and customs to get the ivory across to Asia. And some insurgent groups like Al-Shabaab, Boko Haram, Janjaweed, they have taken this opportunity and, according to some reports, are using the sales of ivory as one more additional source of cash to buy supplies and weapons to commit their atrocities. So if you're a head of state in Africa, species conservation is about national security. It's about an eroding rule of law. It is about lost economic opportunities because some investors will definitely shy away from countries plagued by corruption. And as one high-level official of Gabon told me just a year ago, if an African nation loses its elephants, it will have lost its capacity to govern. And then I think of the symbolic value of species. Those animals that appear in children's books worldwide, used for educational purposes, give me an animal with an E, or for example, the polar bear that is now telling the story of climate change in the Arctic. Now, all these animals, remember how our eyes used to blink when we read the stories of Tarzan and the Jungle Book? They are icons. They stand for a natural world, a complicated and defying natural world, the origin of humankind, and definitely world heritage, which I hope should be preserved for generations to come, and not just as illustrations in children's books. Let us go back then for a moment to Coimbra, Portugal. The good news about that rhino horse theft is the rhinos were already dead. But that is not the case in Africa. And we have been seeing a rise in poaching since the year 2008 that reached a record high last year of 1,215 rhinos killed illegally to satisfy a market for rhino horn over in Vietnam particularly. And that was the destination of those rhino horns that were stolen in Portugal as well. Because allegedly, rhino horn powder, prepared as tea, can have curatory properties against cancer. And because it is sold as a very expensive hangover cure, to the extent that rhino horn has become a status symbol in affluent segments of Vietnamese society. And what this illustrates is how consumers on one end of the world can potentially drive a species towards extinction all the way across the ocean on another continent. And that is no different from us making irresponsible consumer choices here. If you run a hotel business, if you run a restaurant, you will be looking very carefully at the sourcing of your seafood. You want to make sure that your shrimp, your lobster, your fish, they all come from sustainable fisheries that do not deplete the world's oceans. You would never dream of serving bluefin tuna, sashimi grade from the Mediterranean, because that's one of the best examples of a disaster in fisheries management. And then you will look at your stationery, the wood of the furniture, the timber you use to build your lodge, because that must come from certified forestry operations that do not compromise the integrity of the natural forests. And then your tablecloths, your bed linen, your, what else has cotton? Anything having cotton, your towels, will come from plantations that go about very responsibly with the water irrigation, so that water continues to be a resource that is reliable year after year. And your energy supplies. You will be, of course, looking at renewables, solar, wind power, others, minimizing your CO2 emissions and minimizing thereby your impact on climate change. So there are numerous ways, numerous things that you can do here that can contribute very positively to species sometimes thousands of kilometers away and to those people whose livelihoods depend on those species. Let me finish by introducing you a remarkable man that I met 3 years ago in India, Mr. Das. He is a ranger in Kaziranga National Park in his mid-40s, and he told me the story of the time when he was riding on the back of an elephant, and in front of him was the veterinary doctor, and in front of the doctor, the mahout, was actually driving this elephant through the rice paddy fields around the national park. They were looking for a tigress that was raising havoc, killing cattle left and right. So they wanted to tranquilize this tigress and then move her to a safer place. So here they are on this elephant, moving along the sea of green, and all of a sudden the tigress, furious, jumps out of the rice paddy and leaps 2.5 meters high with a claw. She reaches out to the mahout, and he lost 3 fingers of his left hand on that occasion. Then the veterinary doctor falls down on the ground. And Mr. Das is seeing the imminent danger in that the doctor was. So he lets himself glide down the back of the elephant and then starts shooting into the ground. And that did the trick. The tigress was startled and then ran away. But I had to immediately ask Mr. Das, I mean, how could you just shoot into the ground instead of shooting at this animal in a situation of life or death? But Mr. Das responded very confidently. I've been living in Kaziranga for 24 years, and never an animal has harmed me. What would give me the right to harm this tigress? And indeed, the family of Mr. Das has been living for 24 years off the job of Mr. Das as a ranger, off the wildlife of Kaziranga National Park, and Mr. Das cared very genuinely about the wildlife, about the species. And I argue that every citizen of the world today, in one way or the other, uses wild species or their products and enjoys species. Shouldn't we all care and do our share? Thank you.